So SNC-Lavalin has a new interim CEO, I guess COO Ian Edwards inherited that position. But I'm wondering how the former CEO, Neil Bruce, how is he expected to navigate, you know, given all the challenges that SNC was facing?
He came in a really tough position. I mean, he obviously knew what he was up against with the ongoing investigation towards the Libyan bribe situation that has now been ruled by a Quebec court that will be going to trial. But there's unforeseen circumstances over his tenure. We obviously had geopolitical uprising between Saudi Arabia and Canada. About 60% of their oil and gas business is in Saudi Arabia. They haven't been able to win a contract since that kind of came into power. They've had issues in Chile with take-or-pay contracts that they had there that won't be resolved till 2020. I mean, over the last few months, I think the writing was on the wall for Mr. Bruce. He went as far as selling his home in Montreal and moving his family back to the UK where he came from. So then we obviously saw Mr. Edwards promoted to COO back in January, kind of second in command. The street was foreseeing that as a fast track to him now taking this interim post, which I wouldn't be surprised if he becomes the full-time CEO from the interim position he's in now.
Help me read between the lines. Four CEOs in 10 years. What does that mean?
Obviously, the CEO is evidently responsible for what happens. It definitely doesn't screen well from a corporate governance standpoint, which we've incorporated into our fundamental analysis. You've seen that C-suite turnover, a bit of a warning sign, just a negative overhang on the stock. We need to see some stability there, and so does the street, to have that proof of concept that things are actually turning around for the company.
Is privatization an option? Should it be considered now? I mean, breaking up the assets.
They could break up the assets. Obviously, Caisse de Dépôt owns a major stake in the corporation, and so they'd have to be on board with that idea. You could see them break it up. I think they're at the Atkin deal Mr. Bruce acquired back in 2016 for about $3.5 billion. It's a consultancy business. If they had more of that consultancy pure play, I think the sum of the parts from a fundamental standpoint, it doesn't add up. Like you have to put a negative value on their E&C business, a zero value on their $15 billion backlog. So you could see at some point it going private, a third party coming in. But it's really the legal overhang and uncertainty around this bribery case that I think will keep people on the sidelines in the immediate future.
What do you think, or what do investors want to hear now from Ian Edwards?
They want to have a clear, concise restructuring plan. That's really what the board has tasked him with. They've been taking a lot of the right steps, changing the way they're doing their E&C contracts, having more variable pay structure involved in there. They're backing away from 15 different countries that were actually loss leaders. We've seen over the last 5 years the core E&C engineering construction business actually be a drag on free cash flow. And so analysts are actually probably justified in having that negative valuation, that component of the business, because it continues to lose them free cash flow, which is real money. Management is focused for a long time on earnings and income, when I really think they should be looking more at that free cash flow profile. Just because you're generating revenue doesn't mean it's gonna generate free cash flow. And I think you gotta look at your return on investing capital. And so we need to see that restructuring. They're going through $100 million cost cutting efforts. I'd expect to see a lot of that headcount reduction happening in the coming quarters. We've already seen, I mean, the Canadian employees reduced from, I think, about 20,000 back in 2012 to about 9,000 today. So I mean, that trend's moving in one direction. So there's a lot of things he can do, but it's about execution and showing the street tangible results.
I want to dive a little more into that strategy going forward. I mean, what should they be looking for? A big component of, you know, theirs is resource or infrastructure, engineering, as you mentioned. I mean, should they be focusing on solely nuclear? I mean, how do they get that stock back to that healthy, you know, $50 range?
Yeah, I mean, you look at it, they've just are in the process of selling about 10% of their stake in the 407. That could equate to about $12 a stock price. You have another built-in amount that they own in the 407 as well as other concessions. They have the nuclear and Atkins business, which is another 10, 12 bucks there. It's just trying to realize value on this $15 billion backlog in the E&C. That's the core engineering, the core real part of this business, and making that the street represent some value in there. And so they're going to have to find a way to turn that around and start generating free cash flow from that core component of their business.
Is outperform merited for SNC?
So we were talking about it today. It's interesting in that, you know, SNC is by and far a cyclical company, meaning that they'll tend to do better in growth periods in the market and do worse in downturns. But with what's happened from the stock price destruction over the past year or so has kind of decoupled it from the market. And so if you actually saw the market trading lower, it's tough to understand how S&C could go much lower from these current levels without somebody coming in and saying, listen, you know, if I was Berkshire Hathaway and this company's worth $10 billion, but it's trading at three, I'm going to take that public and realize that value. So to get it back to that level, and this is something I talk to my students a lot about, is it's not fundamentals and earnings are something that we can estimate and forecast, but human psychology, what people are willing to pay for those earnings, is much more challenging and a real fact. I mean, you look at the bonanza in the recent IPOs of Beyond Meat or Zoom that are trading at hundreds of times sales. You look at a company like S&C that generates actual cash flow, there's a disconnect there. They're both earning money. It's just the amount someone's willing to pay for that is much different. So that behavioral sway needs to come back to the positive direction. That's probably going to take some time.